Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church of Columbus, Georgia. We're glad that you're here to join us as we worship God by offering our prayers and singing songs and listening to Scripture. Please come in with us that we may worship God together.
In a moment, I will invite all to stand in body or in spirit for our call to worship. But first, let me mention what it will be. This is the 15th anniversary of 9/11. One of the stories that came out of that day was the United Airlines Flight 93. They had gotten word through the phones, able to communicate what was really taking place that day. And they voted to take back the plane. And many of them prayed the Lord's Prayer, and they said the 23rd Psalm before the immortal words, "Let's roll," were uttered, and they fought for their freedom and our freedom. Our call to worship will be the 23rd Psalm today, and invite you to say it along with me, as I think most of us who've memorized it in King James. That is the version that we will be using. But if you would simply like to read along from your pew Bible, you're welcome to do so. So let us be called to worship. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let us worship God. Please be seated. Our litany of remembrance for the 15th anniversary is found in your bulletin set. I will initiate, you'll respond with the bold printed words. At the end, we'll have a Kyrie by the choir, and then we will join in the unison prayer, followed by the fourth verse of A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. O God, our mighty tower and creator of heaven and earth, have mercy upon us. Redeemer God, you blessed the children of Abraham and Sarah and sent them forth. Have mercy upon us. By the liberation of the children of Israel from Pharaoh's hand and the rending of the sea, have mercy upon us. By the ministry of Christ, preaching of the good news, the healing of the sick, the casting out of evil, and the raising of the dead, have mercy upon us. By the agony of the cross and the victory of the resurrection, have mercy upon us. From the forces of evil and from deadly acts of terrorism, from the fear that grips us as individuals and as a people, from the senseless hatred that hardens hearts and minds, from war and violent conflict of all stripes, good Lord, deliver us. Help us, Lord, on this 15th anniversary of the terrorist attacks on the United States of America, so that your rule would govern our hearts and the powers of this world. Lord, hear our prayer. Protect this nation and the peoples of the whole world. Uphold all who strive to bring peace and justice to all your children. Root out the causes of terror and war in all places and among all peoples. Lord, hear our prayer. May those who follow in ways of hatred and violence be turned from their path of destruction and loathing, so that your peace that passes understanding would engulf the world. Lord, hear our prayer. We entreat you to uphold those who lost people dear to their hearts during the attacks and in the conflicts which have followed. Lord, hear our prayer. May your light shine into the darkness that fills so much of the world, so that in your light all would see and know you and your ways. Lord, hear our prayer. Son of God, we beseech you to hear us. Son of God, we beseech you to hear us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, grant us your peace. And the Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. O God, the author of peace and lover of concord, whose heart is glad when all your children live together in unity, we lift to you the grief of our hearts, hoping that you will not only comfort those hearts, but change them, that we may be the people you have created and called us to be, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Did all of my friends make it down? We changed it up a little bit on you today. We're going to do it. I have an assistant today. Well, yes, we are going to do a treasure hunt when we get upstairs. We are. But first, I need to talk to you guys about something a little bit serious today. We've been talking about it since we came in this morning. Today is the 15th anniversary of a very important day in history, in the history of our country. This is September 11th. And 15 years ago today, something kind of bad happened, something really bad. Some people came to hurt us, and they did. And it was bad, it was very sad. And I remember that day very clearly. None of you were here yet, but I do remember it. And a lot of people went to heaven that day, and a lot of people were left behind. Yeah, they did, exactly. What happened was two buildings came down, and around those buildings, other buildings came down because the buildings were so tall and the ground shook so hard that the buildings fell and some of them were crushed. And I've actually been to where this happened in New York City, and some of you may have too.
The old building tore down.
It did. It tore down. Mm-hmm. It messed up the street. But there was one building that was right by where the Twin Towers fell and the other buildings fell. And it was a little chapel. And it's run by Trinity Wall Street, which is a church in New York City. And they have a little chapel there. And that chapel was untouched. Not a brick fell, not a stone shook. It was perfect and it was preserved. And it was used as a place for people to come and get shelter and get water and get food and to pray and to cry and to do what they needed to do after that bad thing happened. And it got me to thinking about our lesson this morning about seeking God in all things. This is a really bad thing that happened, and I'm not going to say it wasn't. Some people think that kids don't need to know about bad things that happen, but you guys already know that. You know bad things happen. Sometimes bad things happen in your life. Sometimes maybe somebody's not nice, or you've got something going on at home, or you make a bad grade. And you guys need to know that in the midst of bad things, God is present. And He was present that day, and He preserved that space for people to be able to come and to find a place of sanctuary and peace. He was present. They sought Him, and He was there. Just like in your lives, every time something bad happens, all you have to do is look to God and ask Him for help. Ask Him to help guide you. Pray to Him. It's very easy. He will provide that love and that peace for you. We do have a treasure hunt today. We are seeking God. He is the ultimate treasure. Liza's a little bit excited about the treasure hunt. And I have a special box upstairs that I made for you guys. And for the next 8 weeks, we're going to look inside of it and find treasure in the treasure of God. So we're going to have a fun lesson. But I did want you guys to understand that it is a special day and we need to think about it. We better go before she busts something. All right, well, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for being in the midst of troubles. We ask that You will keep our hearts and minds as open as they were at that time. Help us to remember what it felt like to be united and to not be separated by the color of our skin or by differing opinions. Help us to remember that we are instruments of You. We are Your hands and feet on this earth. And help us to be examples of Your love to everybody that crosses our path. Lord, we also ask that You will continue to comfort the families that lost loved ones and that those angels will watch over us all. We hope and pray, Lord, that hatred and war and bad things will someday be just a thing of the past. But until that day, Lord, we ask that You will watch over us, guide us, and keep us safe. In Christ's name, amen. Let's go.
Again, extend a welcome to all who are here today and ask you to please sign the attendance pad at the end of your pew. And a greeting also to those who are worshiping with us by the television ministry, whether at the church at Spring Harbor or in your home or hospital room or hotel room, whether you're watching us live now through computer technology or be watching us later, either this day or even into the week, we greet you as part of our church family today. This is a busy day. Our regular Sunday school year has begun for the children and their respective classes. The Center for Christian Studies has begun, as well as In It Together has begun a study of Martin Luther. So I guess playing the Martin Luther National Anthem today, in some respects, our opening hymn. But they have begun next week. A class that Reverend Alvis is leading will begin. Those things are taking place. Also today, it's Church Family Fun Day in the city. You can already see some things being set up out there in the parking lot, a time for us to enjoy our company together, to have a good time as a church family as we begin our program year. Following the worship service, we are acknowledging the Super Bowl of Caring today. You've got a dollar, you've got a canned good to bring. There'll be a youth stationed here and at the front, or the street exit of the church. You can drop something off there. This is also the day that we kick off VIP. We'll be hosting a family for this week. Again, the ways that you can serve, to speak with Margie Bickerstaff about that. This will be later, it's actually a month from now, but the Stop Hunger Now project, we've done that before with area Presbyterian churches. It'll be hosted at Edgewood again, and just can mark your calendar for that. There's signups in the bulletin for events, church family supper, and we kicked off last week. Now we're into our study mode, two options offered. A disciple short study on Genesis, co-taught by Reverend Alvis and Mary Bruce, as well as a shorter study done by John Ortberg, a video and discussion that follows being offered, a church family trip being offered next week. Again, those signups are in the bulletin. And finally, to call attention to something, a letter that has gone out in the mail. Some of you may have already gotten it. Some of you may get it tomorrow, based on the way mail works. But this is a letter of starting the ball rolling in terms of a pastor nominating committee. At this point, asking you to prayerfully consider who will be serving on that committee. And well, there will be seven. And kind of the qualifications and the zones of influence that we're looking for on that committee, and asking you to nominate, prayerfully consider it, and if so led to nominate someone to serve on that committee. The evaluation and planning ministry team will be presenting a slate in conjunction with a session to the congregation later this year, and that will be the pastor nominating committee that will begin its diligent, decent, and in order work in January 2017. So this is another step along the way. So again, go back and check your mail or look for it on Monday. That concludes our announcements. Let us pause and then a moment sing our hymn for illumination as we prepare for the proclamation of God's Word. Our first lesson comes from the Exodus in chapter 13. This is a point where the people have initially left the land of Egypt, are leaving the land of Egypt. This is before the big Red Sea episode. Listen now to the Word of God. When Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them by way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God thought, if the people face war, they may change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led the people by the roundabout way of the wilderness toward the Red Sea. The Israelites went up out of the land of Egypt, prepared for battle. And Moses took with him the bones of Joseph, who had required a solemn oath of the Israelites, saying, God will surely take notice of you, and then you must carry my bones with you from here. They set out from Succoth and camped at Etham, on the edge of the wilderness. And the Lord went in front of them in a pillar of cloud by day to lead them along the way, and in a pillar of fire by night to give them light, so that they might travel by day and by night. And neither the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night left its place in front of the people. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. And the people said, Amen. Amen. This morning, the New Testament reading comes from the book of Galatians, the beginning of that book in which Paul the Apostle describes his own conversion experience. In the book of Acts, there are three separate accounts where Paul's conversion is described, and in Galatians, it is told in his own words as opposed to having someone else tell it. So let us listen that we may hear what the Lord is saying to us. For I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel that was proclaimed by me is not of human origin, for I did not receive it from a human source, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. You have heard, no doubt, of my earlier life in Judaism. I was violently persecuting the church of God and was trying to destroy it. I advanced in Judaism beyond many among my people of the same age, for I was far more zealous for the traditions of my ancestors. But when God, who had set me apart before I was born and called me through his grace, was pleased to reveal his Son to me so that I might proclaim him among the Gentiles, I did not confer with any human being, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were already apostles before me. But I went away at once into Arabia, and afterwards I returned to Damascus. Then, after 3 years, I did go to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and stayed with him for 15 days. But I did not see any other apostle except James, the Lord's brother. In what I am writing to you before God, I do not lie. Then I went into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and I was still unknown by sight to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only heard it said, the one who formerly was persecuting us is now proclaiming the faith he once tried to destroy. And they glorified God because of me. The word of the Lord. There's an old story that comes from New England of some travelers who are in an area that's fairly isolated, and they're trying to make their way from where they are to where they want to go. And they begin to consider this, and finally they ask for directions. And as they ask for directions, the local whom they ask thinks for a minute, and then he responds by saying, "You can't get there from here. You can't get there from here." Maybe you have been in a place where it seems like you cannot get there from where you are. We know that the shortest route between two places, the shortest distance between any two points, is a straight line. But sometimes when we get down to the actual journey, the line is not straight. And in fact, we end up going in a rather circuitous route, or maybe a roundabout way. At the beginning of Exodus, as the children of Israel were leaving the land of Egypt, the Lord laid before them a roundabout way. The Lord said, they may get tested, they may get concerned, and they may run into trouble if they encounter these people right up the road. So let's have them go in another way where they won't encounter the Philistines and the people that might cause them trouble, but send them out so they can prepare for this longer journey. We know that to go from point A to point B in a direct line is the straightest way, it's the most efficient way, and theoretically at least, it is the least time-consuming way. I won't ask for a show of hands of how many of you have ever taken a shortcut that turned out not to be so short after all. Yeah, you got it. But when we go on a roundabout way, when we go sort of a different path, there are some things that are different. we see things that might we wouldn't have seen otherwise. There are different vistas that are in front of us. And by definition, it probably will take a little extra time. But sometimes that time is what we need. That time is useful along the way. That is what I think the children of Israel found out. They found out that they needed some time to get ready for those threats that would come their way. So they were led on this roundabout way. There are times when we face challenges and we face threats. And to avoid them, we must not go the direct path, but we find that we end up going on that roundabout way. It requires preparation to make any journey. It requires effort and diligence. And we find it as we travel around. The state of Georgia designates certain roads they call scenic byways, in other words, roundabout ways. And by definition, a scenic byway is any designated highway, street, road, or route which significantly features certain intrinsic qualities that should be protected or enhanced. The intrinsic qualities are the resources present along the byway that define its character, interest, and appeal. There are six types of intrinsic qualities: scenic, historic, natural, cultural, archaeological, and recreational. For this designation to fit, you have to be able to fit into one or more of those categories. They must relate, again, the definition words, they must relate or contribute to the distinctive character of the region. In other words, the State Highway Department wants to identify, develop, and promote these byways, these roundabout ways, to enhance the life of that region and extend that to enhance the life of the state. They are promoting going on a roundabout way, if you will. When you look at the list of roundabout ways, you will see that one scenic byway is called I-185. Imagine that. The most direct way to get from Columbus to North Georgia and vice versa is to go on a roundabout way, to go on a scenic byway. Sometimes those byways, those roundabout ways, do in fact become the direct ways that we need to travel. This is true not simply for the roads we take, but I think it is also true for individuals. It is true for churches. It is true for organizations. Consider Paul. He was brought up in accordance with what was taught to be right, and he was trying to do it to the best of his ability. He was devoted and determined to follow the law of God as he understood it. But according to his own testimony in Galatians, he encountered something very powerful that completely upended his preparation. And he went on a roundabout way. He went off into Arabia, he says, and then he returned to Damascus for 3 years, sitting and learning and growing in his faith and his ability to speak of his faith. Just what had happened to this God that he understood would not change, and yet now he understood God had sent Jesus, and that changed everything for him. Churches travel in roundabout ways, as well as people. We may find that the route we thought we would take is not where we end up being. This is especially true, I think, for a church during a transitional time of pastoral leadership, an interim time, as we are experiencing here at First Presbyterian. the work of calling the next installed pastor is being done. And sometimes you say, well, can it be any shorter? Can't we get there any sooner? And it seems like we're on a roundabout way. But I would suggest to you that there are some advantages in this path we are choosing or we are going on. One of the things the church continues to do throughout is the mission and ministry of Jesus Christ. But what does that look like now as opposed to 10 years ago or 20 years ago or 100 years ago? What does the mission and ministry of Jesus Christ consist of? The mission field of Columbus has changed, not just in the last year or two, but over the last 50 years, it's changed. Things that were the way they were then are not necessarily the way they are now. Yet, we are still here. We are still on the corner of 1st Avenue and 11th Street. We are still doing the mission and ministry of God. How do we deal with that? How do we deal with all the changes that have come on around us? Uptown Columbus is undergoing a renaissance, some would say. For many years, it has been a financial and a legal center. It's the where the courthouse is and where so much of business is done. But in more recent years, it is also becoming a center for arts and a center for the university. And as it does so, things change. You may notice there are restaurants that are open after 5 p.m., right? But it's more than that. It's more than simply there are things to do. There are more people here. There are more things to do. In addition to students and faculty and tourists who all come here, we also have a significant population of brothers and sisters who are homeless and who do not have a place to live in a shelter that we think of. One of the things that we do in the church is we reach out to them. We offer sack lunches. We participate in the food bank. We try to cooperate with other efforts to find ways of ministering to those who are without. Yet I wonder, as wonderful as these efforts are, I wonder if there is another way that we can partner with other ministry efforts in the city, the churches and the organizations and the business community and the nonprofit world, if we can partner with them to find an end game so that not simply do we feed people, but people find homes so they are no longer homeless. That is one of the challenges that is before us. That is one of the things that comes our way. And it is a wonderful opportunity to be able to have that. That is part of the way in which we are going. And in this roundabout time that we're in, maybe we can find time and energy and effort to address that part of our journey and our calling. A second challenge that comes to us, I think, is highlighted by who comes to town, who comes to Columbus by their calling, by their service. During World War II and for many years thereafter, Fort Benning transformed Columbus. Soldiers came here for training or for to be part of military units. And one of the things this church did was it opened itself up to those soldiers. It provided them places for involvement. And a lot of things happened. Some of those soldiers came and they decided to stay. Some of those soldiers came and found brides in this city and found brides in this church. And there are any number of you who are here today because of that. You opened yourself up. The congregation opened itself up to these soldiers, and something changed. And you were changed because of their presence here. Similarly, We have, because of the opening of the university and other things that are going on in the region right around us, in the few square blocks around us, people are coming to Columbus to live and to study and to stay for some time. What opportunity this presents, what challenge this presents, what way of service this is. I think that by opening ourselves up to all of the communities around us, we will find ourselves in ways of answering God's call of service. It will be different than it was before. Reaching out to and offering ministry and hospitality to people in the 21st century is different than it was during the 1940s. Things will be different. But I am convinced that you as a congregation have the capacity to do that. You have the capacity to adapt, even though you may not give yourself credit for it. You have the capacity to listen to and to respond to the needs that are in the world around us. Being on this roundabout way at this moment allows us to take our breath and to see the terrain that is before us. We may discover, no, I really believe, we will discover that this is a time that leads us directly to the place of mission and service that Jesus Christ wants us to be in the 21st century. And for that, we give thanks to God. Amen. Would you please join me in prayer? Gracious God, we give you thanks for the ways in which you call us in different times and places. We ask that you accompany us on this roundabout journey that we're on so that we may be provided with your confidence and your joy and with the ability to see through the eyes you give us the opportunities for responding to ministry and service. We pray in Christ's name, amen. Part of the ministry and service that we are responding to is through our elected leadership. About a year ago, after all of the vote and the other activities that had gone on here at the church, there was some uncertainty about what the future might be, and the decision was made by the congregation, by you. You made the decision to ask a number of elders to stay. There was not an election with a slate. You asked and you approved that the session that was still in place continue on for another year. And so we have continued on, and now we have approached the time where 12 of those individuals who continued out of that 14, or 11 of those, excuse me, are concluding their terms of service, as well as the deacons and as well as a trustee. And you see those who are outgoing on their terms of service. And as I call your name, I would like to ask you to come forward, please. A number of folks are not here, but Tommy Adams, Bill Arrington, Jim Ballingy. Jim is not here today because Jim is at Spring Harbor worshiping with the congregation that is there, so we are extended that way. Wendy Elliott, Mark Jarrell, Debbie King, Carrie McCoy, Lowry Reed, Catherine Trotter, Cecil Whitaker, and Margaret Zolo, and Deacon Aaron Dow, and Trustee Steve Gumby, I know, is not here as well. But I'd like to ask you to come forward and join me down here at the table. In fact, I'd like to ask you all to come over here so you're facing the congregation. That would be more appropriate. These folks and those others who are not able to be here have done a yeoman's service for you and for all of us. And I think we want to express a gratitude and appreciation to them. There are, we're handing out pins that are made, hewn from a piece of pine wood that was in this church for over 100 years and was removed during the renovation, called by the Spirit renovation. And that wood, as I said, stayed here for 100 years. It helped stabilize this building. And it is a metaphor, it is a story that just as that wood and the pen that it is now in stabilized this building, these individuals and the others who are not here, as well as you as a congregation, you have stabilized this congregation and this people of God. You have responded to the ministry and the calling that God has given to you. And I want to thank you all individually for that. And I think we ought to all thank them too. And that is a most appropriate thing to do on this occasion when we are now ordaining and installing a new set of officers for the next phase of life. But let us offer a prayer first. Gracious God, thank you for the ways in which these men and women have offered leadership and steadfastness to this, your part of the body of Christ at First Presbyterian. We ask that you sustain them individually this day and in all of the other ways, the ministries that you are calling them. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. I would remind them and I would remind you that this is not simply, once they finish the term of service, they are still elders and deacons. Their term doesn't end. They will find different callings, they will find different ways of service, but thank you all for being here. And I'd like to ask if you would just sit on the front pew because we're gonna need you in just a minute, okay? And this is a time now for ordaining and installing the new officers. You see in your insert the list of those, and so I would like to invite those who are to be ordained and installed to come forward. To be ordained as an elder, Pete, and just come up, not as I call your name, but if you know you're up here, come on up. Pete Pease and Ed Kinner, Sally Haddon and Leslie Carnahan to be ordained as elders, and Jim Livingston, Kathy Driver, and Jane Etheridge to be ordained as deacons. If y'all would stand over there for just a second. And then to be installed, Scott Bryan and Marjorie Drury and Margaret Page and Mary Bradley, who I'm aware is not here, Chris Peebles, Eleanor Burnham, Tom Carlisle to come forward, and Lois Johnson to be installed as a deacon. So ordination and installation is a celebration, and you'll notice that Jones and I are both wearing red this morning. You don't see us wearing this except on celebratory occasions. So we're having a party. Woo-hoo! This is a good thing. It's a good thing. And so when you see the red, you know that's a good sign. So please hope you have a spirit of celebration in your heart. I'd like to ask, there are several questions that you see that are there, and then we will have an ordination prayer. I'm going to invite those of you who to be ordained to come over here and stand in front of me this way, face me, and those to be installed to stand behind. Okay, and I've told them, and I've worked with this group of folks, that I've never lost anybody in this process. So they carried through, and they have done great jobs, and we're moving forward with that. But let's if you would answer and declare your intentions in response to these questions: Do you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior? Acknowledge him as Lord of all and head of the church, and through him do you believe in one Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you?
Yes.
Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the Church Universal and God's Word to you? Do you?
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable exposition of what Scripture leads us to believe and do, and will you be instructed and led by these confessions as you lead the people of God? Do you?
Yes. Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you?
Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its disciplines? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you?
Yes. Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you?
Yes. You promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church. Do you?
Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Will you?
Yes. That's a great question. That is such a great question. Energy, intelligence, imagination, and love. May we all have that. That is wonderful. For those of you who are being ordained and installed as elders, will you be a faithful elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, their nurture, and service? Will you share in the government and discipline, serving in the governing bodies of the church? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
Yes.
And for those serving in the office of deacon, will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
Yes.
As the congregation, you will respond to the questions posed by the clerk of session, Jimmy Moy.
Do we, the members of the church, accept these men and women as elders or deacons, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Christ? Do we agree to encourage them to respect their decisions and to follow as they guide us, serving Christ Jesus, who alone is the head of the church?
I'd invite those of you to be, Leslie, stand right there. And if you would come to kneel and to be those being installed to stand behind them. I would invite all who have been ordained as a ruling elder or a teaching elder to come and stand behind us as well and join together in the laying on of hands.
Everybody?
Yeah. Well, I'll give you
one at a time. Okay.
Yeah, one at a time. If you would place your hand on a person in front of you. Okay. All right. God of grace, we give thanks this day for the many different abilities and gifts that you have shared with the whole body of Christ. In particular, we praise you for the sharing and the calling to serve as an elder for Pete Pease and for Ed Kinner, for Sally Haddon, and for Mimi Childs, for Leslie Carnahan, as they come to answer your call in this service. And we pray and give thanks that Scott Bryan and Marjorie Drury and Margaret Page and Mary Bradley and Chris Peebles, Eleanor Burnham, and Tom Carlisle will serve as ruling elders. We give you thanks for the ordination and in the service for Jim Livingston and for Kathy Driver and for Jane Etheridge in this time and for the continuing service of Lois Johnson as deacons for your term. Pour out your Holy Spirit, Lord God, upon these individuals, that they may be faithful elders and deacons to your church. Give them the prudence and the sound judgment, the wisdom and the courage, the compassion and gratitude to order the life of this, your people, your body, in accordance and obedience to your word. We ask that you will nourish them and that they may experience the discernment of leadership with humility and with compassion. Guide the elders in governance on this session and in every council of the church, that they may be servant leaders following Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free. Provide the deacons the strength to enter this school of prayer and serve this community with compassion and courage. Give them all this day that they may walk in faith with a sure sense of your abiding presence in their work of ministry. Gracious God, these brothers and sisters began their life of faith through the waters of baptism. Now you claim them again as your own, called to share through the laying on of hands, to share in your ministry. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon all who have gathered here today, that we may discern the gifts that you have given, calling forth one another, that together we may use these gifts for the good of all. We offer our prayer in the strong name of the triune God, three in one and one in three, who brings forth creation, salvation, and redemption, and whom we know as the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Hear our prayer. Amen. Yeah. You are now, I declare this to you who have been ordained and installed, you are now ruling elders and deacons in the Church of Jesus Christ for this congregation. Whatever you do in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen.
Amen.
Blessings. And it's appropriate to applaud. Blessings. Thank you. I would ask that you speak words of blessing and to these folks at the conclusion of the service.
And also, let us affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. And let us pray. Gracious God, our God of joy and love and hope, we have praised you, we have confessed, and we have celebrated our forgiveness. By your grace, cleanse us of bad habits. Grant us the courage to deal with root issues that drive the habits, and show us the road to recovery. Joyful God, may we truly enjoy our families and friends and not take them for granted. May we remember to tell them how much they mean to us. Loving God, we pray for those we love and all who are special, for the challenges that they are facing, be it tough decisions or battling sickness or grief, troubles in their lives, work issues to be addressed, hopes and dreams to be discovered and pursued. Hopeful God, your hope does not disappoint, and grant us glimpses of hope as we serve. And we pray for those serving in so many ways, our officers that we have ordained, installed today, as well as those serving through VIP this week. We pray for grace to begin again, joy to embrace other people, love to enrich those around us, and hope to go forward. And we pray with the confidence of the children of God, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And let us continue our worship as we present to God our tithes, our offerings, our gifts, and our very selves. All gracious and almighty God, you provide for us and you care for us. As we dedicate these tithes, these offerings, and these gifts, may we remember to put our confidence in you and not to forget your kind words to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
We are on a roundabout journey, a roundabout way so often, but that way is not simply walking in circles or being lost. That way is following the sign and the hope of God, the sign and the hope that comes in Jesus. So stay on your journey, stay fast in it, and as the choir sang in their anthem, be committed to the service of the Lord. And as we do that, we will find goodness and grace and wholeness. May the peace and grace of our Lord Jesus Christ surround you and enfold you. May it accompany you and be with you as you breathe in and breathe out. May it be with you with every step you take and every stride you make this day and always. Go in peace. Amen.
It's been a privilege to join you this day in worship. We're glad that you were here. First Presbyterian Church seeks to serve and minister in the name of Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor. Go in peace as you love and serve God.